How do you imagine what it must be like to work in heavy industry today? Hard and exhausting, the kind of job these men are doing, toiling away inside the world's largest lead and zinc smelter? Well, you'd be right, but only partly right. Certainly, any of these men would tell you that the sweat runs down their bodies under their protective clothing, that their breathing gets heavier and heavier through their respirators, and that they strain every muscle to the utmost. But the sheer hard work of gouging zinc oxide deposits from inside the condenser at the Commonwealth smelting plant at Avonmouth, from the very guts of the huge, demanding and dangerous monster they serve, only happens once a week. For the rest of the time, it's the giant which rules the men. Even in an industrial landscape, the smelter dominates its surroundings. Over 1,000 people work amongst its hissing valves, pipes, steel and concrete, and heavy machinery. But apart from the times that they stop it to poke it, clean it, or tend to the furnace in its fiery belly, the smelter rumbles along, merely minded by the men. The end result of its labours is a stream of molten zinc pouring into the launders at a temperature of 600 degrees centigrade. Although the smelterman today is no stranger to harsh working conditions, much of the heavy physical work has been replaced by computers controlling its automatic processes.
Blast is still at 40,000, I see. What's the reason?
Trouble downstairs now with the slag lift.
In a working situation where the size of the machinery is often overwhelming, does the contribution made by the ordinary men begin to lose its importance?
Men are always at the essence of a process such as this. There's a vast amount of technology and, of course, heavy equipment, but, of course, at the root of it, men are here to operate. And that goes for all levels of operations, staff, industrial staff, engineers, etc.
Mike Smith and Ray Lawmans come as close to anyone at the smelter to physical danger from hot metal or poisonous emissions. They laugh and joke when they arrive for work with other men from their shift, but have long since stopped finding it strange that the first thing they do before they start their jobs as slaggers is to get completely undressed.
When we come in, you know, every stitch of clothing is going to be changed. Right down to your underclothes, your socks, is all changed before you go on the plant and when you come off. So that none of your outside clothes is in contact with lead at all, you know what I mean? So you don't contaminate anybody.
Normally, Mike and Ray would walk through into the next door, dirty changing room, as it's called, completely naked. The company's code of practice guards against poisonous lead particles on the skin, in the hair, or on the working clothes, being carried outside the plant into men's homes. From boots to helmets, even to underwear, it costs £333,000 a year to provide every stitch of clothing the men dress in to do their jobs. The European operations of Australian Mining and Smelting now run this 55-acre site. Commissioned by Rio Tinto Zinc in 1967, Commonwealth Smelting Limited was the first and is still the largest continuous blast furnace of its kind in the world. 12 other countries now operate this type of smelter under license. The raw materials, lead and zinc concentrate, arrive at Avonmouth from all over the world. Conveyors transport the ore into the sinter plant, where 200 tons are roasted every hour in preparation for charging the furnace. The heart of the process is the furnace, and its appetite is voracious. 1,200 tons of coke and sinter, 1,400 tons of air a day, are swallowed by this 64-foot giant. From the base of the furnace can be tapped 40,000 tons of lead a year. Above this, condensed in a shower of molten lead, the zinc, 100,000 tons of it a year, winds its way from the smelter in a silver stream. The plant has the capacity to extract large amounts of zinc from low-grade ores, but in a further process, cadmium is extracted, and the zinc is refined in a series of condenser columns up to a purity of 99.99% before it finally reaches the customer. Cast in a variety of shapes and sizes, zinc finds its way into a multitude of products: galvanizing, batteries, die-cast alloys, paint, photo engraving, roofing. It's used in products as diverse as cars, planes, washing machines, radios, fishing reels, and even toys. Iron catwalks weave their way, linking each section of the plant. The furnace depends on as few as 25 men to operate it on each shift. The focus of the slaggers' attention is the base of the furnace, where they tap molten lead and slag at more than 1,000 degrees centigrade. And to face it, they dress up like modern gladiators.
In the summer months, wearing all this protective gear, it can get you down and make you ever so tired, and you sweat, and it gets right onto you. But there again, it's like Mike said, it's a necessity. You've got to wear it for your safety, you know, your safety aspect of it, and to keep yourself from burning, you know, and getting really burnt badly. When you've got it on, you know you're safe. It's a job that's got to be done, and we enjoy it. Well, I enjoy it anyway, coming in. I mean, I don't like leaving the house, but it's a job to come to. You've got something to come to, and it's interesting.
It's interesting work to be honest, you know, because every day you come in is not the same routine job as like an office job. You know what I mean? It's interesting work, some of it.
The slagger uses an oxygen lance to release the molten lead and slag. Teamwork and understanding are born of a mutual respect for the potential danger they face. The management, in their turn, respects the slaggers for their skills and places their complete trust in the men to get on with the job.
They're not hanging over you and cracking a whip and saying, well, this got to be done, then we'll have this done, then we'll have that. It's like a big family. Everybody works. I mean, if I was to come upstairs and see somebody struggling, then you step in and give them a hand. Or Mike will come downstairs, we've got some trouble downstairs, they'll come down and give us a hand. It's like a family. If the management was to say, Lee Neville, I think the routine of the family would break up. It wouldn't be so, give and take.
How did some of these men come to work at the Avonmouth plant, and what kind of man gets smelting into his blood?
I think he's got to be a bit of a jack of all trades, sort of a character who can take the rough with the smooth. Also, he's got to be able to adapt himself and be very aware of the people in the industries he's in, because there are usually a whole range of people who, and conditions are rough, and you need a sort of, I suppose you may have seen some of these adverts, a man's man, you know, that sort of character.
Well, I was practically born into it. You see, my dad was a furnace man down at Swansea, and of course when I was 18, my dad got me a job down here, and I went up and done the distillation in 1939, just before the war started. That's how I came into this industry, because of my dad.
I had a nice, comfortable office job, plenty of perks, travel, nice hotels to stay in, pleasant people to deal with. But I felt that really, at come the end of the day, I couldn't really see where the job was going to go to. And I wanted to get back to what I would call a real people job and lead something, which I knew that was going to be my own make or break.
I think those people who do stay in, yes, they have a empathy for smelting. Some people have told me that as Charles they used to play about make lead soldiers, you know, and this is the nearest thing. I think there is something in that. I don't know. I wish I did.
I came in more or less straight from college. I did a short time in a plant investigation department, but basically I've been a furnace man ever since. I think once a furnace man, always a furnace man, really.
It's better than taxi driving, what I used to do before, anyway. So I'm quite happy down here, really.
But it's more dangerous than taxi driving.
I wouldn't say that. Somebody could kill you in the street just as easily as, well, more easily than working down here, I'd say.
But it is dangerous to relax your concentration when men are making zinc. Metal stays hot for several hours after casting. Each man owes it to his workmates to stay within the safety rules. The condemnation of friends could be far worse than official reprimands, or a burnt forearm, or a crushed foot. The shift supervisor keeps a watchful eye on all stages of the operation.
Well, when things go wrong on the plant, the operator responsible, I will give him a rollicking, as you say. The old saying is prevention is better than cure, and here it really works, mate. As they are getting burned, and by damn that, that bloody hurt, mate. When it touches you, like, you know, you just can't afford to take any chances. Most of them are, have been on here a few years, like, you know, they've had a couple of burns and they've seen people get burnt or whatever have you, and they know it hurts, like, you know, and it really does.
Molten metal can at least be seen and avoided, but it isn't the only risk. A more insidious possible danger lies in the absorption of lead into the bloodstream. Every person on the plant submits himself to blood tests and urine samples every 3 months. Immediate transfer into a lead-free work zone follows any significant rise, with monthly checks until it's clear.
The monthly supervisions and suspensions are as follows at the moment. No contractors are involved, suspended, or on monthly supervision. The CSL, 5 brought forward suspensions. This is 5 reinstated, nobody left, no new cases, and so no. It is suspended up to the 23rd of January. And of the 14, 6 come from ISF, one's an ISF engineer, one's a Sindra engineer, 5 from Sindra, and 1 from acid engineers. That's all the moment, Mr. Chair.
The medical report by the doctor is one of the matters discussed by the Health and Safety Committee every month. Management and unions come together to consider all aspects of health and safety on the plant. Actual lead poisoning is an extremely remote possibility, but lead absorption into the blood, even if it isn't much higher than you might find in someone who lives on a busy main road junction, for instance, is always a risk and taken seriously.
Necessarily borne out by the annual numbers, you've always got to bear in mind that the standards against which we're suspending are continually tightened.
And from what you just stated now, I would suspect that our performance is a lot better than what it used to be hitherto.
Oh, I think, yeah, I'm sure you're right, Cliff. The thing is improving all the time.
But lead pollution has always been one of the most publicly contentious issues. At Avonmouth, men are living a horror story, said the Sunday Times in January 1972. The smelter is a dispenser of lead poisoning on a literally untold scale, they went on. An inquiry under Sir Brian Windeyer in July of the same year revealed a disquieting number of cases of lead absorption, but no evidence of lasting damage to health. But they were critical of many practices, and changes already underway were sharply accelerated.
Gentlemen, we're talking about the lead in air report for January, bear in mind. And on this occasion, of course, the targets for both the Sintra and the ISF plants have been revised downwards again in accordance with the hygiene control programme. So when I in a minute talk about performance against targets, bear in mind these have been tightened, and you know, in some cases they've been reduced by a third. They're only two-thirds of what they were.
Public watchdogs are ready to snap at the slightest suspicion. There is the state's factory inspectorate, a community health committee, and a local environmental liaison group. But the company itself maintains its own vigilance, spending about £1 million a year operating and maintaining environmental control equipment, including looking for heavy metal pollution and sulfur dioxide emissions up to 2.5 miles from the smelter. It is an industry acutely sensitive to criticism, and in such an industrial complex at Avonmouth, with a multitude of heavy plant, public confusion, such as mistaking the smelter for the chemical works, makes them feel, with or without justification, under siege. But teething troubles, or built on the cheap. It's been admitted that the problems of running the biggest smelter in the world safely and efficiently were seriously underestimated. But 5 years on from their worst public drubbing, they hope the major problems have been beaten.
Yes, we do have problems, but we do attend to them effectively, and I think very quickly. And there's no problems of a kind that concern me in terms of solving. I think that because it's a lead smelter, the effects of producing lead require that we achieve an even higher standard than what might otherwise occur in industry. With this type of industry, you must be responsible to everybody concerned in order to exist. We have to be responsible to the people that work here, we have to be responsible to the community around us, and we have to be responsible to the regulatory authorities that have a responsibility for this type of industry.
But the greatest problem the world's largest zinc smelter has to face today is selling its product in a market that has collapsed. There's been a cutback of 20% in the company's production at Avonmouth, because for almost 5 years now, the world's zinc market has cooled to the point of serious concern. The commercial director, Bob Wilson.
Well, for us, the first thing that happened was that we started building up stocks to the point where it was really uneconomic to continue to try to finance a higher level. And since then, we've more or less been running our production in line with current level of sales.
It meant that you had ingots of zinc stacked all around your premises and unable to sell it.
Absolutely. And at the moment, I suppose, in this plant, we're operating at something like 80% of our capacity, which is pretty normal, maybe slightly higher than the average for the Western European industry. Oh, it's quite unprecedented. I think that in early 1976, we all saw a forced dawn. It looked as though the US economy and the US zinc market was really picking up quite well. But that lasted for about 2 months, and by the end of the second quarter of 76, the market had fallen back again, and we're still waiting for the elusive recovery.
On that recovery could hinge the future of this plant. Bristol and Avonmouth has had a long connection with zinc. William Champion in 1738 patented zinc production from a plant in Warmley using ore from the Mendips and coal from Kingswood. It's 50 years since zinc was produced on this site. In one of the old methods of making zinc, by horizontal distillation, the work was hard and physically punishing, and there are still those who remember it.
There was nothing to touch that distillation. That was a real hellhole. You take that from me. Hard, dirty, rotten, stinking work. And all we had on was a pair of trousers and boots.
No safety.
This weather was nothing to us. We'd walk down to breakfast, nothing on, just our boots and trousers.
The only clothing we had was just a pair of mitts for your hands, because all the tools we were using were red hot. They had to go inside a red hot furnace, and all the tools we were using were red hot. You couldn't do nothing else, just a pair of mitts. But as I said, we had to supply all our own clothes, which was very hard to get then. We had to depend on second-hand shops or things like that to get their clothes.
Well, the situation in them days is nearly the same as it is today, because you've got 1.5 million unemployed at Edinburgh. Well, I've seen as many as 50 people outside that gate waiting for jobs. And if one man did step out, it was about 50 waiting to come in. They used to call this the white man's grave years ago.
Looking back, do you wish you'd done some other kind of job?
I don't think so. I don't think so. I'm only a labourer. I don't profess to be anything else.
Is it a good industry to work in, though, generally?
Yes, it is.
Even though it was so hard?
Yes.
Well, why is it a good industry if it's caused so much physical devaluation?
Well, as I said just now, you had the comradeship. You'd never let anybody down. You wouldn't see anybody work harder than themselves. If anybody was stuck, they could step in and give a handout.
In one way, yes, I regret they're gone, but in another thing, I think modernization makes the job easy for the man.
Well, isn't that right?
Well, that's how it should be. But some people don't want to pull their weight even these days with modernization.
If we wanted the money, we had to do this job, and we was more or less all...
Dramatic change has taken place in the working lives of these men. Those days are now just a memory. But what, besides economics, dictated change?
I think the rightful desire of society to see better systems of manufacture. And I think the old idea of labour-intensive industries of that kind, hard slogging industries, have gone forever. We certainly don't support that concept here, although parts of this operation are hard, but they are a vast improvement on what used to be.
The beginning of the process of making zinc is the sinter plant, where the ore is roasted.
Okay.
Starting up the plant from the control room is an operation as nerve-wracking to the casual observer as the advance of some great leviathan. The plant superintendent is a New Zealander, tangible evidence of Australian mining and smelting's worldwide operation, who will soon depart to their head office in Melbourne.
You know, I'll be able to pick up the phone and talk to somebody who knows me, knows my attitude, can read between what I'm saying, and you can have a face-to-face across a telephone.
And is that what this company lacks, as far as you're concerned?
I think they need more of it. They don't lack it totally, because the people at the Melbourne end make a real effort to do that.
Do you think that to the Australians that this country is a wee bit remote?
I think they've got a very big problem, because they have a lifestyle in Australia. There's a very different lifestyle and a different set of attitudes here and in Europe. And I think that they've only got an opportunity to come over here once or twice a year. Principally, what I hope to be able to do is to use the operating experience that I've gained here and the operating experience that I gained in Wedel, Holland, which is the electrolytic zinc smelter that AM&S half own, to put what I might call a bit more realism behind proposals that are going to the board.
The recession in the world zinc industry has hit the Avonmouth smelter hard. But the advantage of being part of an international industrial octopus is that the unprofitable parts may be kept afloat by the sheer size of the corporate body.
It's unlikely that we're going to be profitable again before the end of 1979, and maybe even that's a little bit optimistic, because there is now enough zinc in stock already around the world to keep all consumers happy for about 3 or 4 months. It's going to take a long time after the market's improved, before those stocks have run down.
Zinc production needs long-term planning, which economic depressions play havoc with. Commodity dealing on the metal exchanges, price-cutting wars, and rumblings about protectionism are the unpredictable backdrop to a disastrous recession.
Every man working in an industry which is making losses obviously has to be a bit worried about the future. But I certainly wouldn't emphasize it as being a serious problem in this case, because unless, and I think this is very unlikely, unless we see a further decline in the zinc market, we'll be continuing to operate here so that our sales and production are more or less in line. So we'll continue with our current level of operation until things get better.
Well, this production cut must have some effect on morale, because people in this industry, because it's a production industry, are motivated towards operating at maximum rates. And if you do operate at maximum rates, then it generates a degree of enthusiasm which is quite stimulating. I feel that we've got a good team of people here, both above me and below me, and that what we need is an improving economic situation for this industry to operate in.
Today, the price of zinc is half what it was at its peak in 1975. In the 10 years since the plant was opened by Harold Wilson, the workforce has almost halved. So where does that leave a qualified man with legitimate hopes and aspirations?
Well, the company isn't as big as it used to be, therefore fake openings aren't available that were, that there used to be, so I'm just wondering if one's, you know, one's been too long on shift now.
What's the answer?
Should have got out about 5 years ago, I think. I think you just wait, really, the situation. I'm a bit specialised, really. There's only three other men doing the job I do in the whole country, so it's rather difficult to find other jobs at the moment.
well, it's bound to make you think about it, I suppose. So I'm thinking of myself as being here for a long time. And obviously if the bottom drops out of the market, it's going to affect everybody that's working here. So, well, it's bound to make you think about it, yeah.
Well, I shouldn't like to be redundant again. I haven't done it at my age anyway.
Do you think that's a real possibility?
Oh, you never know.
No problem or no decision about the future is made without considering the effect this would have on the people who work here. Not just, if you like, not just the people that work on shift work, but the staff, people, everybody, and also the people in the community.
In spite of the trough the industry is passing through, individually on the factory floor, men are cheerful, doing a difficult and demanding job, which most seem to take a genuine pride in.
Well, I don't think there's another job in Bristol where you can get the experience, the friends, the atmosphere,
the money,
and the working conditions, where it's something to get used to, and it's a lot of experience to have under your belt.
Well, I don't know. I just don't know. I just like it. I mean, I can't tell you why I like it. I suppose there's a little bit of pride somewhere tucked away in here. Like, you don't see that you think yourself, well, I haven't done bad. Like, you know, I've done a fair old job today.
This is the first time that I've ever worked in a factory, and seems pretty good, like, you know.
There's only one thing we're here for, and that's money. That's all we go to work for, isn't it? You've got loyalties to the company and your mates.
If you're looking for personal opinions, perhaps it's because everybody no longer knows the man at the top, and the man at the top no longer knows everybody.
You've got to take the job as it comes. The heat, the sweat.
They seem to muck in down here more, they all muck in. They help you out. There's always bags of advice going. Nothing's too much problem for them. Well, what I'm here for is the money, really. It's a well-paid job. You don't mind working hard if you're getting well paid for it. And you're also getting very well looked after.